Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the 1 o'clock session. Our session is Malicious Documents, Emerging Trends, a Gmail Perspective. And our speaker today is Elie Bursztein, Security and Anti-Abuse Research Lead at Google. In order to make this a much more pleasurable experience, could you please all mute your cell phones? Thank you.
Bonjour. My name is Elie. I work at Google, where I lead the Security and Abuse Research Lead. And today, we're going to talk about malicious document as seen through Gmail. So for those who are interested in getting the slide of this talk, I made them available at the URL you have here. I also posted them on Twitter. I also like to mention, before we get started, that I try to keep this presentation to the point and as concise as I can, so I have time to answer your question, and I give you the information you need about the topic. So, malicious documents have been on the news quite often lately. For example, in October 2019, anomaly reported that a APT group, APT Russian group, Primitive Beer, did use some of the malicious office document to target Ukrainian entities. And looking from the news, it's hard to tell whether or not malicious document is a trend and how important it is. If we look at scale, and we look at the Gmail scale, it turns out that, as far as we can tell, in the last few weeks and over the last few months...
Could you project a little louder? It's a little hard to hear.
It's hard to hear me?
Sorry. So if you could project a little.
Is it better? Okay, sorry. Sorry, okay. Okay. So, if we look at scale, if we look at the Gmail scale, in the last few weeks or few months, we do see indeed that malicious documents make up for the majority of what we block from preventing the reach user inboxes, whether it's for end user or for enterprise. Very, very recently, in the last few weeks, we actually do see that office documents make up for about 56% of the malware we block. PDF is only 2%. That being said, please take this with a caveat as usual. This is a trend. This is more like a snapshot of what is today. Probably in a few weeks or in a few months, attacker might decide that PDF is better than Office or some other exotic file format, and they will switch to that. However, we have seen consistently through the last year that malicious document is one, if not the biggest, way people try to get into our user inboxes. So that confirmed what the press showed, that it's a big deal. Now, before I delve into more into what they are and how we detect them and stuff like this, let me take a step back and tell you a little bit more about how we do detection at Gmail. I know that's one of the questions I heard a lot is how the whole thing works. So I propose to walk you in the next few slides on how the Gmail detection works in, at a very high level so you get a sense of what we do. So overall, every week, we do scan about 300 billion documents to prevent and to find malicious documents and other malware and prevent them to reach our user inboxes. So where we do that is we have every second to scan millions and millions of documents in a matter of milliseconds to be able to operate at that scale, right? So how we go about that? Well, so where we do it is in basically three stages. The first thing we have is called a policy engine. So what does a policy engine do is Gmail only authorizes a specific type of files. For example, since its inception, we don't authorize executable file. So exe would be rejected from the get-go, and other file format like Windows Link and so forth have been forbidden through the years. So basically, the policy engine looks at the attachment and determines whether or not it's an acceptable attachment. If not, it's rejected. If it is an acceptable attachment, we move on to stage number two. In stage number two, what we do is we run many scanners. Some of them are custom, some of them are traditional antiviruses, who's going to scan the attachment, all of them independently and in parallel. So each of those scanners will decide for itself whether or not, based on its rule and system, whether or not it's malicious or not. And then we have a third stage, which is called the decision engine. And the decision engine, what it does, it combines all the detections and weights them and decides whether or not, ultimately, you get the email or not into your inbox. And that's basically what we do at scale. And so we have that in multiple data centers so we can scale up to the 300 billion documents we need to scan every week. So one might ask, okay, so you scan things very, very fast. So obviously, how do you deal with things which are more advanced and which are for enterprise and consumer, which are at risk of being targeted? Well, the answer is, we also have something we call like a slow path, where we actually use sandboxing technology and detonation chambers that we use for a specific type of document or specific user to when we have a DOM. And those are used to supplement our detection system. So we do use them. We just don't use them for everything because it doesn't make sense. And it's way more cost effective and more practical that way. So we have detonation chamber as well. We have talked about it previously. All right. So now that you have a better sense of how the whole system works, let's talk a little bit about what we block. So in this talk, I'm going to cover 3 points in turn. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you about who is targeted by malicious documents, right? The first thing is who is targeted. The second one is we're going to go and delve into what is the anatomy of a malicious document campaign, what they look like, what they exist, and so forth. And finally, I'll give you some insight about how we detect them and what we plan to do and how we improve the situation and keep improving our defenses. And then we'll take questions. All right, so let's start with who is targeted by malicious document. Well, before I get into the trend, a disclaimer, these are just trends, and really, one day or another, everyone is at risk of being targeted by malicious document. Even though some people are, at the moment, more targeted, it doesn't mean that, that you are not targeted, it just means that you are less, and you might be more in the future. It's very something which keeps oscillating, so take this also again as a snapshot of what is today rather than a long-term trend. So today, what we see is the most targeted type of organization by malicious documents are governmental organizations, and they are quickly followed by nonprofit and companies. And the one which is the least targeted is EDU, so university and so forth. This is based on the people who have a G Suite domain, right? And so people who are in the organization domain have a one-time chance, let's say, and then companies are 3 times more chance to get targeted by malicious document, and industry, government 4 times more. If I break it down by some of the industry sectors, I'm not going to show you the full list, but some of them which are interesting, we see that manufacturing, utilities, and transportation are the one at the moment, as of February, the one which are the most targeted. And then we have a middle of a pack where we have information technology, retail, and trade. And then, a little bit surprisingly, in the last few weeks, we have seen financial sector to go down and be less targeted. Again, this is more like a cyclic pattern rather than a long-term trend, but as of now, this is the picture. What's interesting about this picture is, yes, some industries are more targeted, and this is something where we see differences. We can also cut it down by country, if you want, and then for country, again, very interesting picture. Some countries like Germany or India are very barely targeted, whereas US and France make up for the middle of the pack with a 15 chance more being, which are at least 15 times more of being targeted by malicious document than, let's say, Russia or Indonesia. And then at the extreme tip of the iceberg, we have countries such as Norway, Great Britain, and Finland, which are way more targeted at the moment. I don't have a good explanation for it, to be honest. We look at a lot of statistics. It's not clear why. It's just we observe that the ratio of malicious document to the number of amount of email for those countries is higher. Again, that's kind of what a seasonal thing. I remember 3 years ago when I did something about phishing on trend for Gmail at RSA, Japan was the number one. So as I said, it keeps evolving. But yes, we do see actors shifting TTPs, both in terms of what they use and who's the target through the years. Okay, so now that we have an idea of who is targeted, the question is how, right? So how they're targeted? Well, before I get there, just a quick interlude about cats. What cats have to do with all of this? Well, cat, like many things in life, is mostly static as a data set. If you were to take a picture of a cat in ancient Egypt or in Middle Age or now, they almost look the same. Cat barely evolved, same thing for humans, and if you were to build a data set to learn what is a cat, what is a dog, once you have collected it once, you can use it for almost ever, barring a nuclear winter. On the flip side of that, when you deal with security and when you deal with malware, that is not the case. And actually, one of the most requested statistics is how much a landscape is changing under our feet, right? Well, The answer is 63% as far as we can tell. So what we believe is 63% of the malware we block today have been different from day to day. So 63% is how much we see, which are different today from all the previous day over the last 14 days, I think. And then that's keep going, and that's kind of consistent. So sometimes it's like 68, sometimes it's 59, but give or take, we always see at least 50% of more malware. And the reason for that is not that there is 63% new attack. This is not what we say, because that's not true. What we see is people trying to change things a little bit to prevent caching, hash busting, basic detection, static rules, and all of these things. So basically, any static system is bound to fail in this kind of environment, which means we have to be being reactive and being keeping an eye on it every day. There is no one I train and then I'm done. It's more like every day we have new variations and what they are, and those variations are adversarial. What I mean by adversarial is mean these are not random variations. They are things where people try really actively to evade antiviruses and to evade scanners in a way that they try different things to try to bypass our defenses or any kind of AV makers defenses as well. So, in terms of burstiness, that's exactly the same story. Malware detection is not a steady process. It is actually something which hugely varies, and this is, I took 14 days of our data, and basically you can see that if we normalize, we see a variation between 1 and 2, 3x. So some days we see 3 times more malware than the previous day, and we have to kind of deal with this kind of spike, and you're like, okay, 3x is not that bad. True. Well, these were 14 lucky days because sometimes we see massive spike. What do I mean by massive spike? Well, here's one. In 2016, I like this example because it's a little bit, it was in the press a little bit. We had Loki, which was the most famous ransomware at the time, and it was basically blasting samples to everyone using a botnet called Nicure. And what Nicure would do, they will come up on Monday, come up with a great idea, and send us 100 million samples on a given day on Tuesday. Realize it doesn't work, come back to the drawing board, try to mutate the sample, try again, and again, 100 million. And this is the type of spike we see. And someday we see nothing. This is not errors, right? This is nothing, 100 million, nothing, 100 million, nothing. That's what we have to deal with. So if you ask the spike is between 0 and 100 million documents. And this is the type of burst we have to absorb that every kind of ISP have to absorb, and that make also the job interesting because we have to do a lot of capacity planning as well. We have to do a lot of latency analysis to be able to absorb this kind of massive spike. And again, we have no idea when they're going to spike. Maybe today we have a big spike, maybe tomorrow. We just know they exist. So the burstiness of the detection is also an interesting characteristic of the landscape, which is fundamentally different from, let's say, normal regular visitor from a website where you have where people wake up, go to the website, go back to sleep, and so forth. We don't have diurnal pattern. We have massive burst who goes up to hundreds of millions of documents. And when you're really unlucky, you have two groups who decide to do it the same day, which happened once when DryDex and Loki decided to do it on the same day, and then you have even more massive one. I didn't capture it on a graph, but that did happen. All right, so the malicious document threat landscape is both very fast-paced and extremely adversarial. So as I said, it poses interesting challenges in terms of updating your detection capability as well as your ability to absorb spike. It also means that what you learn as trend today will not be up to date in 3 months. So you have to also, from threat intelligence perspective, keep looking at it and keep changing. So the knowledge kind of get outdated quite often. And the question you can ask is how they do it. Right? Because at the end of the day, some people are very competent, but we know the 80 to 20 rules, right? There are a few people who are very, very, very smart, who do 80% of the smart thing, and then you have 20%, which is a vast majority, who use it. So the question is, why do we see so much variation, right? We saw 60%, 63%. Well, our answer, at least one of them, is our theory, is that there is a black market which is fueling malicious documents. And we have seen it time and time again. In the last 5 years, we believe it has grown quite a bit. So basically, if you go to any black market forums, you will see a lot of what I call kits, which basically say, I offer you weaponized document exploit, like old CVEs or more recent ones. Some of them claim also to have 0 days. And then they pack that with AV evasion techniques, which says, OK, I'm going to obfuscate it. So basically what you do is you supply the executable you want, ransomware, Trojan banking, whatever you have, and then they would pack it into a document, whether it's a PDF, Office document, or any other type of malicious document you want, and they claim they make it fully undetectable. Underneath that, you have also, as illustrated on the left side here, services, which is like virus total, except they don't submit it to AV company, and these are used to test your fully undetectable document. It's called FUD on the underground names, and this is what they do, right? They have services to test whether it's detectable, and they have kits to pack them. And those are sold between $400 or $5,000, or they're a total ripoff too. There's a bunch of scammers, so most of them don't work, to be honest. But hey, some of them are real, and we believe this is what's fueling this whole diversity thing, because everyone, not everyone, many of those bad guys are using these kind of kits, and we believe this is what fuels at least partially the black market. So the reason why we believe that is because we have analyzed quite a few of those documents, and so to deconstruct the campaign, let me show you what one looked like, right? So let me show you one of those techniques. I'm going to walk you through an example. Okay, so here's a VBA macro taken from a document which we believe was generated by one of those kits, which we taken from VirusTotal sample, right? And so I'm going to walk you through how this huge gibberishing works and what it really is. And we're fairly certain this has been generated by one of those kits because it seems very programmatic. So the first thing we have at the bottom is hash busting technique. So what they do is they create a ton of variable and a ton of expressions like concatenation, arithmetic operations, which absolutely do nothing. All it does is it tries to pad with things to evade signatures, to evade hash sync technology and so forth. So basically, it makes caching almost useless at that point, for at least for this type of document. Then, in the middle of the pack, we have a function name, where basically what is the script is doing, where they try to obfuscate what is the function call. In that specific case, if you were to take all the yellow boxes and combine them and do all the replays, you end up something which is wscript.share. So what this does is this is a VBA function call to spawn a share, right, on the Windows computer. Why do they do this? Because there is a new trend. Actually, it was reported, as I link on the slide, by Talos, I believe, which is called LOLS bins, which is living of the LAN binaries. So we see a trend where what they do is instead of writing their own executable, they actually try to use executable which are already existing into the onto the Windows. And in a specific case, we'll see which one they're going to use, but basically the shell is launching a known binaries, which is already signed by Microsoft, so that's all normal, with a parameter which will subsequently download the secondary payload, right? So now what we need to know is, okay, so they use the share. What they pass into the share? Well, that's the last box on the top, right? So the last box on the top is a function parameter which are obfuscated. And basically what it says is mctha, which is the name of an executable. I'll go back in a second. And then the URL of where to download this file, right? So what is mctha? mctha is a Microsoft HTML application execution helper who has the ability to execute this thing from a remote addresses. So what they do is say, please Windows script launch a share who's going to call mctha and download this thing, which is a malicious part of the document. This is a very well-known technique. The MITRE have a whole page about mctha that you can read. It's on the slide, and so basically that's one of the techniques. So what we see is, and that's one of the interesting technique we saw is they stop relying on their own code. They try to look and use as much of the Windows ecosystem because with the improvement of defense in Windows, it's harder for them to use non-signed code. And binary are very easy, and antivirus are easy, have an easier time to do that than this. So basically, that's what a modern dropper looks like. Very, very different from the one we see 2 or 3 years ago. So that's basically what we see again and again and again. And we see variation, to be honest. And of course, we have one line in the middle of all of it, which is please execute this obfuscated function with parameters, and that's what it is, right? Sorry about that. And of course, we see variations. This is a cute one. They're like, okay, let's make the thing harder for scanners by hiding some of the parameter inside the Excel cells, because of course you can use Excel formulas to actually do the computation. So what they try to do is hide bits and pieces of the computation across multiple macros, across the cells. And it seems that Excel is favored for this kind of advanced evasion because it has more computation capability and more place to hide. So that's also one thing we see. And so to take away about what the malicious campaign looked like today, I could have showed you 20 examples, but honestly, these are mostly what it is. So I'd rather show you one clear. The malicious document landscape is phase-based and adversarial. As I said, it's going to change. It keeps changing. And that's one of the biggest challenges. We believe that it's something which is driving really, really hard, this kind of fast-paced thing, is a few groups of people who sell those kits to make those documents unexploitable and make it very easy for people to reuse CV, like the infamous NSA et al. Blue vulnerability, right? And they weaponize that, make it very easy for people to do single click, like, let's execute that binary with that. So those guys are the ones who make the money and profit from that. And then the evasion technique have become more and more sophisticated by using living off the land binaries and trying to use advanced obfuscation, and basically there is a commoditization of that, and I think that's a big trend that we need to take stock of and make sure we deal with. All right, so if that's a trend, and then if we have to deal with more and more adversarial or more and more hash busting and obfuscation technique, what can we do? Well, the answer that you probably heard all week, and the floor show might be full of, is we're going to use AI, right? I mean, I'm pretty sure you have heard many talk about that, and you'll be like, really, one more of those talk? Okay. Well, the thing is, at least for Gmail, we don't try to do AI-based detection. We try instead to use AI in conjunction with other things to use interpolations. So what we like about AI is that the fact that it's really good at interpolating between known samples. We don't claim it's going to detect unknown attacks. What we say is because we see so many macro which are variant of each other, that with the right representation, actually AI is really good at interpolating. And that's all we try to do. And our job, the goal of AI and the goal of my team who did all the research for that, was to actually come up with a way to increase coverage. So it's not we try to replace, it's we try to extend our capability with AI and also with a lot of code, which is basically extracting the features. To be honest, the AI part is tiny compared to the amount of effort you need to do to understand the document and extract the right representation so the AI can pick it up. If you want to have a proposition value about why AI is interesting and why you should have one of those in middle, is because at the bottom left corner here, we have traditional antivirus, which have a very low total cost of ownership and deal really well with bulk malware, not so much with obfuscation or zero days. And at the top right, as I alluded earlier, we have sandboxes, which are really good because you can detonate the thing, so you really run the whole thing, and so obviously that's really efficient. So the problem is, well, there is something in between, which is a gap, and we believe that's where AI has its place. We don't claim we're going to replace. What we say instead is, let's add the third one in the middle, who bridge a gap between bulk malware and sandboxes and do it really, really well with all the obfuscation we had before. And that's kind of what we built. And you'd be like, okay, how does that work in practice? Well, the idea of how it works is, let's say we have documents. What we do is, first, we have a document analyzer who understands the document format. So you have to have one for each. And then this document analyzer, what it does is going to extract a bunch of features outside of the document, like how many words there is, is there a macro, how much variable there is, and so forth. So a bunch of statistics about the document itself. Then it's going to feed them into machine learning, but that would not be enough. What you need to do, and because a lot of them are macro-based, is to have something which actually understands the language, so literally like almost like a mini compiler, if you would. And so you're going to have to parse the macros. Then, as I showed you, there is a lot of obfuscation. So now we spend a lot of time having AST and simplification to remove all the obfuscation and try to deobfuscate and come up with a representation which is a little bit more stable. Then we transpile it to another language to be able to do supervised execution. And then we have, in its very limited cases, and this one is not yet in productions, supervised execution to actually do some sort of the eval. So what you can do with script languages is JavaScript evaluating itself, or thing which keep evaluating, evaluating, evaluating. So you have to step through those to keep unpacking things. So that's why you need that. We don't have it yet in production, but it's something we're experimenting with. And basically, you need all those components. And to be honest, most of the AI research is about how to get all those nice components working together so we have a good representation of what's happening in the document so the machine learning can understand from it and extrapolate from it. So if we go back to our diagram, basically how it works in practice is, well, we added another scanner with our collection of scanners at the top. Here it is, which is TensorFlow, and basically we train on it and we process all the document, train our representation, and as we scan, we add it to our collection of scanners as a supplementary scanners for a specific type of document. And if I stop here, that's a horrible marketing presentation, so I'm not going to do this. I'm going to say, does it really work, right? No, because the whole thing is, okay, you don't have to take my word for it, so how does that work? Well, here it is. We launched the first version of it in production. So this is something who do protect your inbox if you're using Gmail or if you're using G Suite for Microsoft Office document with scripts. And the answer is this is, well, the last 30 days. And in the last 30 days, the scanner have increased our detection capability by 10% consistently. This is the blue bar. And we also have the machine learning, which was really good at finding spike, which were up to 150% in the last 30 days. So the question is, does it work? Yes, it does work. It works in very specific cases, to be honest, but they work in the place where we want it to be, which is the biggest problem, and supplement our conservative detection. So one thing we learned as well during this whole step, and it took multiple years, was that we have to be very, very specialized and very, very focused, because each of the document type have a very unique set of attack and set of techniques. So you have to build one at a time. And so that's the first one. We're really happy to have it in productions. And we feel it helps a lot to protect users, many of you, I guess, who have a Gmail account or a G Suite account. So interestingly enough, as I told you, if we break down the detection improvement by file type, as I told you, there is more wiggle room for shenanigan in Excel files. So it turned out that the machine learning is really good at picking that up. So we almost have 50% more improvement for Excel than we have for docs. So that kind of makes sense because that's where most of the complicated obfuscation take care of. And so that's the one which is mostly missed by other scanners. So that's basically what we did. A question we have, obviously, is, okay, when you build machine learning, you need to build it. We need to label data how you build ground truth. So the answer is going to be disappointing because I don't have a silver bullet for you, but we have a combination of techniques. So what we do is we combine a few things. The first thing is we do hindsight revaluation. So what we do is we store the sample for temporarily, and then after a few days, we rescan the whole set of samples and we relabel them with the scanners that we have in prod, but again, offline, because that gives time to all the scanners to adjust for false positive and false negative. And we see quite a bit of turnaround. Then for every document where we are onshore, or many of the documents we are onshore, we send them to sandboxing for sandbox evaluation to get the complicated one to make sure we have another verdict, and we combine that as well. And finally, we have a lot of clustering tools to actually try to cluster into campaign and try to understand what might be false positive, false negative, and we use that for visualizing. And this is a combination of all of these which help us to build the ground truth. So it gives us a really good ground truth. I don't think it's perfect, but it gives us a set of label we can train on. What is our deep clustering tool really do? Well, this is what you have. So what it does here, it's a projection of the clusters in 2D. The blue are the good ones, the red are the bad one, right? And what you can see, besides looking like a dragon, is everything should be working mostly fine because the bad things are basically grouped. Except here, where it's a little bit of a mess. And you're like, okay, this is a little bit of a mess. So then we can zoom in and we can get this thing and we can say, okay, well, what is happening here? Because there is confusion. And the question, when there is confusion, there is potential for FP and FN because it means the machine learning is not able to separate them. So it turns out this is an example where the machine learning decided that if you have .dll, so if you have a DLL which is loaded through the VBA macro, it must be bad. It's not quite true, so we had to readjust the machine learning and the feature extractors to say, well, don't do that because that's going to cause a lot of false positives. So this is the reason why clustering is useful for us. It helps us to deep dive into the various type of sample we have and try to understand what features, what type of things the machine learning is picking up and try to correct it to avoid those false positives. So to sum up, Malicious document is a key threat today, and we believe this is a trend which is not going to go away. I cannot predict if it's going to be Office document moving forward still, or it's going to be more of also moving back to PDF or another file format, but for sure, Office document is something, document, Malicious document is a key threat. Also, be aware that the things are shifting very drastically, and you know, if tomorrow a great PDF exploit kit surfaces on the black market, we're sure we're going to see a lot of PDF. If there is a lot of vulnerability found in Adobe PDF or Fox Reader or something like that, we also expect the black market to weaponize them. So keep an eye on that. Usually there is a few moments between the vulnerability is disclosed and it's weaponized, but this still happens quite often. And then finally, we don't believe there is one way to flag malicious document. We believe you need a lot of different scanners. That's what we do. We do some sort of ensemble learning across as many scanners which have different way of detection. So we have orthogonality, and we make it harder for bad guys to evade our system by having those different type of detections. And basically, that's all I have for you today, because I wanted to take the time to answer some of the questions you might have. I didn't know what to expect, so please stand up and to the mic, and I will happily answer your question. Thank you. Or we can finish early if there is no question. You have a question. Okay, two questions. Okay, well.
Yeah, so you mentioned some about Gmail already stripping certain attachment types like executables or links. And I recently remember you guys maybe removing JavaScript as well. What about like archives? So, you know, do you do any sort of simple archive extraction to look at maybe a JavaScript inside of a zip file? Or what is Google's plans around archive attachments?
No, yes, we do. Yes, absolutely. So archive are authorized. That's the first thing. Yes, you can send a zip file or a RAR file. And yes, when we do scanning, the first step we do is we have to carefully, and it's because, you know, there is zip bomb and all the stuff, we have to be very careful of decompressing the archive and do scanning of all the documents into it. Then there is a problem when there is a password, and then in that case, obviously, we can't do it. But when there is an archive and we can unzip it, yes, we do. That being said, for me, it's actually better. From the user perspective, it's in an archive because it's harder, right? Very few people would go and like, okay, I need to unzip the thing, and then I need to click on the thing. So it's harder for the attacker to get to the machine of the user. So archive is kind of a positive thing. Is that the question? Okay.
So given that your service is public and anybody can use it, how do you cope with the fact that maybe just train your algorithm? Now as an attacker, I can exercise my document and change it a little bit until it passes, and then I'm free to send my campaign whatever I want.
Yeah, so what you, okay, so the question is how do we deal with adversarial attackers who spend their time probing our system? There is no good answer, to be honest. There is a set of answers. The first thing is we retrain very, very quickly. It's in a matter of hours, or at most in a matter of days, because we know that if we don't, then actually stop working well. So first thing is a lot of retraining very quickly because, yes, the thing is changing, as I said, every day, so you have to deal with that. The second thing we do is some of our technology is never discussed because we don't want to make it easy for the bad guys. I know a lot of people want to have more transparency of what we do, and this is understandable, and we try. We try to also balance with the fact that making it hard to probe is easier. So yes, that's basically what we do. We might choose also other tactic. I talked about it, I think, 2 or 3 years ago, but we do delays. We also try to use, to try to also to not get poisoned. There was attacks a long time ago, or there's still people trying to do reporting things as non-spam. So for spam classifier, it's even worse. People try to say, this is not spam, this is not spam. So we have to also making sure our data set is not polluted. So that's why we use multiple angle of rescanning things and reputation. So that's what we do. We try to limit the probing as much as we can. But as you said, it happened. And they have an army of tools on the black market to do it. So yes, it's a very complicated thing. And bypass occur to everyone. To be honest, it happened. I mean, that's all there is to it.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
I have two quick questions.
Sure.
With one of the slides, you showed, or you gave us an idea as to the countries that would probably get a lot of the targeted.
Sure.
Right. So do you also have an idea as to which countries send the most malicious documents?
Yes, I do. But yes, we do. I tried to do that a long time ago. It's not very interesting. And I can tell you why it's not interesting. The country who have the biggest internet bandwidth and the most data center are the ones sending the most. Or alternatively, the country who have the oldest computers, if you're talking about botnet, are the ones who are sending the most. So for example, in Nexture in 2016, and at that time we did publish a map, you can see Nexture botnet was mostly, I believe, in Turkey, Pakistan, and I think maybe Iran, don't quote me on that, but something like those kind of country. And the reason why is because it was only running on old Windows. But if you want to look at the Burk thing, basically people who have good bandwidth have cheap hosting, and when they do massive scanning, it's either botnet or cheap hosting, right? So that's basically the two of them. So it doesn't tell you anything about the attacker. The attacker is not going to send it from his home computer. So that's why we never disclose it. It's not that interesting. Okay. That's the answer. I hope that answers the question.
Yeah. And the second question, do you guys also scan image files as well, like JPEGs and PNG
we,
files?
So we do scan for phishing, malware, and spam, right? That's what we do. So we do scan images, also exploit on images are fairly very, very tiny. But yes, we do scan them from our too. Unlikely, but do exist, and yes, we do scan them.
Okay, all right, thank you.
Hello. So my question was, you showed AI as a point between your AV and your sandboxing. So my question is, how much, if at all, has the AI reduced the amount of documents you have to send to a sandbox, and then what is the overall proportion of things you end up sending to a sandbox anyway?
Okay, so I think I can answer the first question.
Okay.
I don't think I can answer the second one because we never talk about how much we send a small fraction. For the second question, all I can tell you is we send a small fraction, obviously, because you cannot scan 300 billion documents with a sandbox. That's not going to happen. So we have techniques on how to decide which one to send, and that's something which we're not ready to talk about. Now, for the second question, for the first question, which is how much does it reduce? It doesn't reduce anything. As I mentioned, we don't want to do that. What we want to do, I'll go back here, give me a second. What we want to do, and that's what we do, is we adding it on top of everything else. It's an addition. We didn't remove anything. We just scan more and we pay more. For us, it's not a matter of paying more. When I saw the total cost of ownership is, if you prefer, is like how much we can scale the thing. We cannot scale obviously the sandbox to everything, but for malicious document, when this project will grow, again, this is now only for office documents, which have macros, but we plan to extend it, we will be able to scan everything with AI. It's a little bit more costly, mostly because the development is harder. You need more engineers to develop it internally. And there is the cost, because obviously you run TensorFlow and you run deep learning and stuff like this, so it's a little bit more costly in terms of CPU and resources. But it's to the point where we can scale. So the point was, there is a place where you can spend a little bit more and get a completely different type of protections. And the power of AI is to have orthogonality, because it's not something that is not based on traditional signature or what other people are doing. This is something we do on our own. And so it makes it harder for the bad guys to evade everything at once. And again, our main priority is to protect users. So we rather run both and be successful and, you know, scheme on the detection. So this can empower.
Awesome.
Answer the question? Okay.
Hi, I was wondering, I think it was on the first or second slide, you were saying like 54% is office documents and 2% is PDFs, and I was wondering just what is the remainder, what else, what other documents
are you
blocking? And the second...
Yeah, I'm getting back to it. This one, right?
Yeah,
right.
Just what is that?
Well, on top of my head, I'm not sure. I know there is archive. We have archive, which is also contained malwares, and then we have those. I know archive have some of them. Why archive? I don't know. I haven't delved too much into it. I would assume archive is one of the biggest ones. I do believe we should have HTML document, which might contain a link to a malicious site as well, stuff like this. So I think I would say archive and HTML, but I'm not sure. To be clear, I'm not sure, but I know those are two we see flaring from time to time, so I would assume that. There was some RTF attacks a few months, a few weeks back, where basically they were using some weird thing on RTF. So that type of stuff.
Yeah, and also just with the office documents, are they mostly in English language, or are there other certain commonalities that you found?
I don't know. I don't have that type of information. Sorry, this is literally a scale for the world. I don't know. Sorry. Oh, you answered your question. Great. Okay, one last question then.
Yeah, I had a quick question. What is your detection rate? Like, can you share that? Like,
for which one?
Just in general, like malicious documents. Like
Okay. So that's a great question. Can I share that? Well, it's actually public. Let me go back to this one sec. It's 99.9. As far as we can tell, we believe that for spam phishing and malware, the Gmail spam classifier as a whole, right, based on what goes into your inbox and your spam folder, we are about at 99.9. The AI itself, I don't have a conclusive number for you, but we are about that as a range too. Again, we take a very conservative approach. I talk about it, if you're more interested into the false positive and false negative, actually I talk about it in 2017, where I show that we actually skew our false positive and our false negative quite differently. So what we try to do, and it's going to depend on malware versus phishing versus spam, but for example for spam, we would actually be conservatively putting things into your inbox because we don't want you to miss important emails and into your spam folder. So we actually have a little bit of a skew. It's 99 point something. I think it's 99.4 and 99.9 point something else. So it's public, but around that area. All right. Thank you so much for attending. I think I have to remind you to fill out the form and things like this. I hope you have a great RSA. Thank you so much.
All right, don't forget to grab all your personal belongings. All right, and thank you. Also, fill out the evaluations on the RSA conference app, please. Thank you.